This episode is brought to you by Shopify. Whether you're selling a little or a lot, Shopify helps you do your thing, however you cha-ching. From the launch your online shop stage, all the way to the we just hit a million orders stage. No matter what stage you're in, Shopify's there to help you grow. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/special offer, all lowercase. That's shopify.com/special offer.
Put down that smartphone and listen to me. I'm Matthew Milligan, professional musician and lifelong Weird Al fan. Each week, I'm joined by professional podcaster and close personal friend, Matt Kelly, to take a dive off the deep end into the vast career of pop culture icon Weird Al Yankovic on our show, Weird Algorithm. Along with some very special guests from the worlds of music and comedy, we tackle every song, every television appearance, and every bit of sketch comedy Al has produced in chronological order, covering the good old days of My Bologna and Eat It, the fun zone of Tacky and White and Nerdy, and everything in between. As we go, we're ranking the songs, albums, and music videos in the hopes of creating the ultimate guide to a career bigger than the biggest ball of twine in Minnesota. So the next time you're having one of those days stuck in a traffic jam wondering why does this always happen to me, just kick off your sneakers and stick around for a while because we've got it all on Weird Algorithm, available wherever you get your podcasts. And now you know. Was that enough references?
This episode is brought to you by Shopify. Whether you're selling a little or a lot, Shopify helps you do your thing, however you cha-ching. From the launch your online shop stage, all the way to the we just hit a million orders stage. No matter what stage you're in, Shopify's there to help you grow. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/special offer, all lowercase. That's shopify.com/special offer.
Hey everybody, it's producer Matt. July has been filled with travel and sickness and just trouble scheduling people who write books. So what we are doing this week is actually a replay to an episode of Alyssa Explains It All when Erik was the guest on Alyssa's podcast. And this is basically how their entire friendship started and where I started to build the idea of like these two could host a show together. So I hope you guys enjoy this flashback walk down memory lane. And then in 2 weeks, we'll be back with a regular episode. If you happen to be in San Diego for San Diego Comic-Con in, I believe, 2 weeks, make sure to swing by the Geekscape booth. Get yourself a YAOK bookmark and say hello to me. I'll be there. But in the meantime, enjoy this flashback episode.
It is so nice to meet you.
It's nice to meet you too. Thank you for having me.
Of course. How have you been today? How's your Wednesday?
Oh, it's great. It's wonderful. It's actually not freezing out and it's a nice day. So that's good.
Yes. Where are you? Are you in New York somewhere?
Philadelphia.
Okay. All right. Yeah. You actually live in a really interesting place and this is like so not why you're here, but I just need to know about your haunted house.
Our house is built in 1895 and it is very haunted. So I have a friend who she's a psychic medium. Mm-hmm. And so the way she describes it is it's kind of like there's always a radio on and usually she can turn that volume down. So when she's like sober, she can turn the volume down. When she's drinking a little bit, that just volume knob just does not work for her. And she was here for a party once and we were giving her a tour and all of a sudden, she's just like, okay, well, there's a ghost in this room.
Oh,
there's
my God.
A little girl. Also, upstairs in, like, actually where I am right now, there's a closet. And she just straight up refused to go in. And anybody who has stayed in our house, usually our guest room is on the third floor, like, down the hall from that. And everybody has been like, I don't know why, but it's really, really creepy. And it's really uncomfortable. And I had a horrible night's sleep. So one day, my partner goes, he's just on Craigslist looking for random stuff, like art and everything for the house. This is after we moved in. And he texts me, he's like, oh, I'm going to stop in Germantown and pick up a painting from a school parking lot. And he comes home and it is the most horrific doll painting. Like this painting is haunted.
Oh, no.
And he puts it up in the bedroom that everybody's having trouble sleeping in.
Good.
Since then, there has been no ghost activity. The ghosts stay out of that room. They're scared of the doll. So we call her Dinara, and we say that Dinara is watching over you, and everybody's like, yeah, it's really
horrifying.
Peaceful up there.
That's so
no, they're like, funny. As soon as the lights are out, they don't see her, and they're like, oh yeah, this is the best night's sleep ever.
Oh my God. So you had like a haunted house that was canceled out by a cursed image.
Yeah. One time I came home from work and I could not find my dog. So he's a little Shiba Inu. He's 20 pounds. It's a, like, he could not get anywhere. There's no way for him to get out of this house. And I can't find him. I'm walking all over. I'm on, going on all the floors, looking for him, trying to find him. And we had just had a holiday party. So this was before the pandemic. And we took all of the dining room chairs, brought them up to, like, the room that has the little girl ghost in it. And we put them all in there up against the door that leads into this little access room to our bedroom.
Okay.
And there's two doors that both close opposite directions. The one gets stuck that's going into our bedroom. You can't actually open it unless you like shove into it and then again to shove it closed. And the other one closes and locks. Somehow he ended up in that little doorway, locked in.
What?
The other door is barricaded by chairs. My bedroom door was shut. The door to that room was shut. And he's just been in there all day. I have no idea how he got in that door shut and how it locked. Because it's shuts going in. So it's
right.
Not like he could pull it shut.
Right,
and
right.
It's a drafty house, but that door does not shut if it's open. So
wow.
It happens at least. So no
that
clue what
is
happened with that.
Spooky. I love the 19th century. I think it's so like interesting. And a lot of the books that I read end up being from like that time period. And so I would hypothetically love to live in a house that's that old, but this is what I'm scared of.
Okay. Well, they're fine. They don't like do anything to hurt anybody. It's never like a real horror movie. So
it's like a friendly ghost,
yeah.
Like a checking in and mm-hmm. then that's all.
Yeah. And
okay.
Every once in a while, she'll want to play with the dog. Like one Halloween at like 3 a.m., there's just like a ball rolling across the floor and then it starts bouncing. And I thought the dog was playing with it. But I like my partner leans up and like goes to yell at him. But the dog is on the edge of the bed just watching all of this happen.
See, that would freak me out so much. That's scary. And I love scary movies. I think I might draw the line at it happening in real life. That's... And I think that happens in a scary movie with a ball. So
it's funny though, because like when my partner used to travel a lot for work, and mm-hmm. so of course he doesn't like horror movies as much. So every time he traveled, I would like, oh, I'm gonna watch a horror movie tonight.
Yeah.
And it's never the ghost stuff that scares me. It's always mm-hmm. like, what if there's a serial killer that tries to get into this house? So I'm like Kevin McAllister when I'm home alone. I just like. Locking
traps.
Certain doors that never get locked. And I'm
yeah.
like, listen, at least if the alarm goes off in the middle of the night, I know there's at least four locked doors between me and this serial killer.
I love that. I love that. Next, you'll set up some booby traps, some flour outside so you can track their footsteps.
Yes,
you'll be good to
exactly.
go.
Exactly.
I think that's a great idea. Well, so I'm really excited to talk to you because you have a book that was like... It had been recognized in a bunch of different ways, and it came out last year called All That's Left in the World. And I started it actually earlier today, so I'm only a little bit into it, so don't spoil it for me.
Okay.
But I've been enjoying it so much so far, especially because it is like a dystopian end of the world situation, but it's
yeah.
also quite funny. So like I'm listening to this and it's these two boys who are among the last in the world and they find each other and eventually fall in love. And I'm also like laughing at how they're like one of them is almost dead when he arrives to the other one's home. And I'm like, and I'm still laughing. And I was like, this is amazing. How did you come up with that concept? Were you inspired by the pandemic?
I know. So it was actually written before the pandemic. I wrote the first draft of it in 2015. And at the time I was watching The Walking Dead and I got annoyed because there were only straight characters on the show at the time. They've since had like a whole bunch of other queer characters throughout. But I just kept thinking, I was like, well, what about all the queer people? Like, if we're already kind of like a minority, mm-hmm. then most of the world is wiped out. Does that mean it's harder to find a date at the end of the world for gay people? So I was like, I started wondering about that. And then at the same time with societal collapse, it means that there's somebody who may not have had the ability to explore his sexuality and now doesn't have any hangups about it. And he, right. that is something he can think about. And so I just kind of wanted to put those two ideas together. And also, it was, we're just, queer people are underrepresented in post-apocalyptic fiction, which mm-hmm. has changed so much just in the past year, which I do think is because of the pandemic. My friend mm-hmm. Andrew Joseph White, he's a New York Times bestseller, and his book came out last year called Hell Followed With Us. It's about this trans boy who survives this post-apocalyptic viral event that his fundamentalist Christian church basically caused.
Wow.
And he's like slowly turning into a monster while he's falling in love with this boy who is, there are a bunch of survivors from an LGBTQ center in, that's in the city. And it's this, like, he, it's funny because we both read each other's books before it came out. Mm-hmm. And the way in my story, you've already read this part, where the meet cute is basically the one character's holding the other at gunpoint.
Yes.
And so I get to it in his book and it's the exact same thing. And I sent him a like screen cap of it. I texted to him and I was like, I love our post-apocalyptic story so much.
I love that. I feel like you guys have to have universes that somehow converge, like yes. Marvel and DC at some point. They have to come together.
It's a multiverse of madness, and it's just all of the queer yes. post-apocalyptic stories coming together.
I love it. I think that's very important, and I yeah. think that that's the next step in the storyline, even though I'm only a little bit through the story, and I'm already loving it so far. I love this whole concept.
Everything, Every Queer, All at Once.
Everything, Every Queer, All at Once. Yeah, I love
that's what the title's going to be.
I love it. I love it. Your book has actually been pulled from a school library, which is actually very serious yeah. and terrible. There's no way that this collab is going to make it through.
Oh, yeah, no.
Was it
that
just...
was a fun Google alert to get on, I think, yesterday morning.
Yeah. What the heck happened? Was it just one school?
So far, it's just one school district in East Tennessee. I think it's
wow.
like Blount County, Tennessee. Mm-hmm. They said it was smut, and it is promoting deviant sexual themes. And that could not be more farther from the truth. Like, it's a very, very chaste book. These two boys are trying to survive. They're not trying to fuck. So it's
right.
like, I don't know where they're getting the smut shit from, because
right.
the front cover of it has their pinkies like barely touching. And when they were designing the cover, they originally were like holding hands. And I was like, that's giving too much away. Let's separate their hands a little bit. I want like lesbian period drama level angst where they're just like barely touching.
Yes, I love that. Did you think that this was a possibility with writing a book like this? Because, I mean, again, like, I'm not very far into it, but it doesn't seem like it's a young adult novel. Like, I can't imagine it turning into like a Game of Thrones sex scene all of a sudden.
I'm honestly shocked that it took this long. I'll be
really
frank. Yes, I thought it was going to be a lot sooner. I kept seeing they're trying to ban a lot of queer books now. And I would like every time a new list comes out, I scroll down. I'm like, why am I not on this yet? And so like, I'm genuinely surprised it took as long as it did. And yeah. it's not surprising at all, because I knew it when I wrote it that people would eventually do this, because it's always how they do it. They immediately equate sexuality with sex. Because
right.
they assume because the word sex is in the word sexuality, it means that you cannot be anything but this smutty, deviant sex fiend if
right.
you acknowledge any sexuality that isn't heterosexual. Which, by the way, a lot of the heterosexual people I meet are also smutty, deviant sex fiends. So
yeah.
I don't know why it's just made all the queer people in. So,
right. It's this weird, I think that there's... It's so frustrating. I can't imagine how frustrating it is, like, to be the person who wrote this book and also be a part of the LGBTQ community, to see something be silenced that's so normal. And had it been a heterosexual relationship, it would have never been considered
yeah.
to be smut. It's, like,
they it, and it has nothing to do with actual sex. It's just right. they think the act of being in love and not heterosexual is deviant. That right. is what they're viewing.
Right.
And there's plenty of other, when I was writing it, in my mind, I was like, all right, I'm not going to give them reasons mm-hmm. to basically ban my book.
Right.
I want them to look like idiots when they try to do it, because there's not going to be any sex. There's going to be violence and language, which they do not mention that. I say fuck like 85 times in this book, and they do not mention the language. So even I'm working on another book, and in my mind, I was like, when I was typing out this conversation, I had one character who was just going to use the word cuntiness. And I was like, I can't put the C word in a YA novel. I won't do that. I went back. I had put down bitchiness. I went back today and I changed it to cuntiness. I'm
Period.
Like, screw it. I don't
As
care.
As you should. Because they're not going to ban it for that anyway. They're going to be.
They're not going to care. And no one's going to care about it. I could have the most chaste book in the world. And as soon as they find out that, one, I'm gay, two, there's one gay character in it, they're going to ban it. There's I'm not playing by their rules anymore. I tried to be like, look, this is how it is. And they're so far out, mm-hmm. it doesn't matter anymore.
Yeah.
So I was talking about it with my agent yesterday. I was like, you know what? I don't really care. I'm not going to play by their rules, because they don't play by their own rules anyway. So
100%. I think that's a great way to be. Yeah. And do you feel like when you were deciding the types of books that you wanted to write, that you were going to have to choose what you do with your platform in terms of like finding a balance between being an activist and being an author? Like, or did you actively make the choice of like, okay, I'm going to kind of sit in the line of both by writing books about queer people so that you finally have representation that you deserve, knowing that it would pull you into a little bit of activism?
I know that there's probably a lot of queer people that disagree with me, but I think just being queer is activism on its own. Like, you are required to do this. You can't mm-hmm. sit by. You, just because I'm a white dude, it means I do have privilege. There is a certain amount of privilege that I have naturally. I can walk down the street and nobody will know I'm gay. Mm-hmm. If I open up my mouth, they might. Or if I'm like dressing flamboyantly, I have that ability to do that. It's not something I want to do. I don't mm-hmm. hide who I am. But if I am in an unsafe place, I can do that. Mm-hmm. And I think there's so many people in the queer community that can't do that. And now they're just like, especially like everything with trans people, just trying to use the fucking bathroom.
Right.
And it isn't fair for them to be the only ones fighting. So, I mean, as a white guy, I do have to be on their side with everything, because I know the way it starts is it's a stepping stone. They will start with trans people because they think there's not enough of them. They can't fight back as well because we can get queer white guys against them. And mm-hmm. we can say all of this shit about trans people being groomers, and now all of a sudden it's just drag queens, but now it's gay people, and it just one thing after another. And for you to sit there and be like, oh, well, I'm a white gay guy, I don't actually need to do any of this, so I don't want to get into politics. It's like, you don't have a fucking choice, because they're coming for you next. It doesn't matter.
Right.
So that was always my stance, is if I'm going to be writing queer things, which is what I want to do, because I wanted to read that when I was a kid, or I didn't know I wanted to read it. I sought out certain things when I realized that it existed, but all of it was for adults. It was very inappropriate for me to be reading. And which is the other thing about them banning my book, they can either read my book or mm-hmm. they can read an adult book that has queer characters and has queer sex in it and is way more explicit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's all these kids now on TikTok who are reading like Colleen Hoover books, who are, she's a straight author, but her stuff is very inappropriate for children, and they're very popular on TikTok.
Yes.
And nobody's banning her books because she's straight.
You know what's weird about the Colleen Hoover books too, is there's a lot of like abusive relationships that are being glorified in those books. Like, I read Verity and I liked it, and then I read It Ends With Us, and I was like, oh my God, I can't cute. This is a no. And I closed, I was like, that's a no. And so for you to give this story, that's like, it has a storyline of these two boys who are also 17. So like they're engaging in like a very, you know, sweet little love story that's appropriate for like 17. Yes. And so for that to be demonized is just, I don't want to be surprised, but it's so like, it's so frustrating.
Yeah. And it's a 360 some page book, and mm-hmm. they don't even kiss until like probably 340 pages, maybe.
Okay.
So sorry, it is a slow burn.
That's all right. I'm happy with a slow burn. And also, the writing is so funny. Like one of the things that I wrote down was LOL Tom Holland. Because in the beginning you say something about wanting to kiss Tom Holland. And I was like, understood. I get it. So I'm fine with the slow burn because it's already very entertaining.
That was the other thing. I was trying to just make it, especially like The Walking Dead, mm-hmm. a lot of post-apocalyptic and dystopian stuff. It's just like so heavy. And yeah. I think that's good. But I think with queer people, we like a lot of us use humor as a defense mechanism. And mm-hmm. why wouldn't this person do that when all of his family and friends are dead and he got stuck in a bear trap and is injured and on the verge of death? Why wouldn't he still be making jokes about these things just to keep his spirits up? And so when he meets Jamie, who doesn't have that, he's like, oh, this is actually somebody that's kind of getting me out of my own depression in my head mm-hmm. where I'm just kind of like obsessing over things.
Yeah. So you wrote this, you started this in 2015 and then the pandemic happened. And were you like,
I got my agent with it in 2019 and okay. we did a little bit of work on it in the fall of 2019. And I sent him what would be the final draft that we would send out to editors in January of 2020.
Okay.
And I had already known about COVID because China was on lockdowns at the time. And like Wuhan has the population of New York, Philly, DC, and Boston, I think. Mm-hmm. And so like when they did a quarantine lockdown, I was like, oh, this is bad because that's a lot of people to basically lock in their houses for several weeks. Mm-hmm. And so I figured it's at some point it's going to be coming over here. I didn't think it would be at like it turned out to be, but I remember he sent out, like, my agency sends out a newsletter of things that are going on submission in the coming months, and editors at different publishing houses can email them and say, hey, I want this when you send it out, in case mm-hmm. my agent hadn't put them on the list. And he did that in the end of January, maybe early February. And he said mine was the most requested book that they had ever had on something. And in that email back to him, I remember asking, I was like, oh, do you think it has anything to do with this coronavirus thing? And like looking back on it, I'm just like cringing because I'm like, ugh, what an idiot. And he responds like, he's like, yeah, I think that's part of it.
Yeah, but no one knew. And I think at the time, especially like now that we've gone through it, it seems so silly and naive. But we had had like these experience, like these kind of like close brushes with things. Like I remember during like there was bird flu. There was
swine flu in like 2008.
Yeah, there's
SARS in SARS. Was that like early 2000s?
I think so, because I think I was quite young for the SARS situation. Yeah. But all of those, like they were sort of threats, but we were like scared and then it calmed down and it was fine. And so this time around, I moved to Los Angeles March 1st because I was just so sure that it was going to be fine because it's always been fine. And my God, was I wrong? And by like March 10th, we were totally shut down. So that was, it was just a wild, like no one could have really known how that was going to go. So then the book actually came out in 2022. So you had pushed it out because of the pandemic, I assume?
It sold in March. It's actually sold March 13th, Friday the 13th of 2020. I remember getting the call that it was sold and we had a deal and I was like, okay, good. I have to go though, cause I have to go to the grocery store cause we're locking down on Monday. Like the city was like, oh, we're going to let you do the St. Patrick's Day stuff all weekend. And then everyone just stay home on Monday.
Like, you could have your fun and then it's over.
I was like, usually publishing works very slow. I have a third book I'm under contract with, and that one is due next Wednesday, a week from today, actually.
Wow.
And it will not come out probably until next year. And I will edit it with my agent or my editor until September of this year is pretty much when it has to be in order to get it out by like summer or fall next year. That's the way it usually happens. With this one, it was 2020 and they had set it for 2 years later because they wanted things to kind of quiet down a little bit. I think they expected it to. Mm-hmm. And then they also didn't really, like, as we got further and further into the pandemic, they were like, oh, we're going to have to change some things from the book, because I wrote it from just my own mind thinking, mm-hmm. oh, this is exactly how we would respond to a pandemic. Turns out that was wrong. So my editor was like, oh, we need to start kind of figure out if we need to pull in like real things that happened, mm-hmm. or if you want to set this in a world where COVID didn't happen and it's more idealistic, where they actually tried to stop it from spreading.
Right.
So it was like,
where they actually tried.
Yes. So it was like kind of several months of just waiting it out, seeing what would happen,
yeah.
and then slowly tweaking it. I think I had to have the final draft in the October before it came out. So October of 2021, I had already pretty much finished the entirety of the story itself in the beginning of 2021. But as it kept going on and things were happening, I'd have to kind of remove things that were mm-hmm. too close to home and keep changing it all the way up until I think October or November of 2021, which is unheard of. They yeah. usually are like, you cannot change things anymore mm-hmm. once it's in like copy editing phase. And I was still changing things through several months up. So,
wow. What was like one of the strangest things that you had to change?
I actually ended up removing an entire plot point, not plot point. It was like a throwaway paragraph where they were talking about vaccines, because I didn't want people to think I was an anti-vaxxer.
Oh.
And I also had this line where I'm trying to like fill in the blanks of what happened in the entire world in this book. And I said that Russia released a vaccine that ended up not being tested at all, which did happen. So I was like, oh, cut that out. And so yeah. I changed it to like France or something. And then yeah. Part of it was that the vaccine was actually, because it was untested and they didn't do anything, it like ended up hurting a lot of people. And I was like, oh no, I don't want people to think that
right.
I believe that. So no, I'm cutting that out as well.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're listening and you haven't gotten vaccinated, get vaccinated.
Just it's do fine. It. It's fine. Fine. Everyone is fine.
We know what's going to happen with the virus.
Mm-hmm.
It's better to know that.
Yes. Agreed. Agreed. Wow.
Just
that is.
Vaccinated.
Yes. Just do it. It doesn't even hurt. Just do it.
And then there's one thing that ended up staying in that I thought was very strange. It was during summer of 2020. I had written, you'll get to it at some point. There's something that a character says, not mm-hmm. Andrew or Jamie, it's like one of the antagonist characters. He says something that I had written, and then later during like all of the anti-mask protests and everything that were happening, people had the same thing written on their protest signs.
My God.
And I was just like, what the fuck?
So are you psychic, you think, or are no. human beings just this predictable?
No, I think they're just that predictable.
Yikes.
Because it's Yikes. Like, I did try to like, it's not created in a vacuum. Those
right.
specific things were said by other people that were maybe in Germany in like the 30s. And I think that's why they were on those protest signs.
Right.
But I kind of took that and I made it American. And of course, so did the crazy people from the state of Alabama. So
yikes. Just yikes. That is wild. So now that you've had the success from All That's Left in the World, do you feel like your experience in kind of like writing after that and seeing, I mean, I think the book has been, you had, you were, I saw that you were, what's it called? nominated for a Goodreads award. I love Goodreads.
I was on the YA sci-fi.
Yes. And there was another one too. Oh, emerging LGBTQ voice. Like, you had been recognized in so many ways. Do you feel like, because now you have a lot more eyes moving into your next book and the following book, do you feel more pressure or do you feel like?
I'm very nervous about my second book, which is coming out in May.
Lose You to Find Me.
Yeah. I'm really nervous about that one because it's very different. This one was written in April of 2020 while I was waiting for notes on All That's Left in the World. And at the time, I just kind of wanted to write something that was more just like a comfort project for me. And I was like, I don't want any high stakes. I just want this like cute little fluffy rom-com. And I pitch it as Empire Records in an old folks home.
Cute.
And it's actually based on the job that your producer Matt and I had in high school. And that's actually where we became friends.
Wild job to have in high school, by the way.
Yeah, we were servers at an old folks home. And it is Matt might even agree, I don't know, but it was probably one of the best jobs I've ever had, just because it's everybody that we worked with, we were all like this close-knit kind of like family. We never would have been friends outside of Matt and I obviously were, but some of us like would never have been friends outside of this weird job that we all had.
Right.
And so I wanted to kind of write about that. And I wanted these friends who were just kind of going through like romance and their final years in high school and figuring out their lives. And all the while they're just trying to deal with their messy shit and serve old people food. So yeah. I didn't think anybody, when I pitched, my contract with my publisher was basically they bought All That's Left in the World and then whatever my second book was going to be. And I gave them a list of three options and Lose You to Find Me was on it. And they chose that one. And I never thought they would. I just kind of put that on there as like a extra in case, just to show them like, look, I can write more. I have plenty of ideas.
Range, yeah.
Yeah. And they chose that one, which it doesn't have a hook like All That's Left in the World, which is a post-apocalyptic queer romance. This one's just a queer workplace rom-com. And it's also more coming of age. And I'm like, well, what if people are looking for more post-apocalyptic stuff or like genre fiction? And then are they going to be disappointed in this? And people who enjoy rom-coms, are they going to think, oh, well, he doesn't know how to write a rom-com because he wrote a post-apocalyptic thing. Like, if they hadn't read it, they don't know that I'm very funny.
So very funny.
I'm kind of nervous about it. And all I can hope is that it connects with people. That's it.
Yeah. So yeah.
That's what I'm hoping. I'm leaving it up to the universe. All That's Left in the World, I didn't think as many people would connect with it as they did, but I'm hoping that the same thing will happen with this one. So
I think it will, because I think as much as is the the post-apocalyptic setting, I think what really carries it through is that it is kind of still a rom-com. Like, it still has this really nice romantic comedy theme that carries you through like this, what would normally be a really traumatic, I mean, it still is traumatic, but a traumatic story. And you found a way to carry it through in such like a lighthearted way, which is a crazy thing to do.
Yeah. And I will say there's good response to it. Everybody who has read my other book and specifically sought this out and read an early copy, they have all said that it's distinctly me, which I think is all I can ask for, because it's like, okay, well, then that means it's definitely connecting with you. You get me. You get my book. Okay.
Right. Right.
So I feel better about it. And it was fun to write, because with All That's Left in the World, it's a dual point of view book where you just go back and forth between Andrew and Jamie every single chapter. And most of the book is just the two of them together and maybe one or two people that they run into on the road. Whereas Lose You to Find Me is, and of course, All That's Left in the World is up and down the entire East Coast of America. And Lose You to Find Me mainly is contained in this retirement community. And it has a cast of over like 40 characters. Mm-hmm. And so just getting all of those different people and finding all of their voices and how they interact with each other was just so much fun to write. And my favorite thing is just seeing people's reactions, because there's one character who started off as a background character. He was basically just, he would be mentioned every once in a while. They'd see him at a party and that was it. And as I was writing the book, I realized, like, I was kind of writing backstory for him and how he interacts with the main character. And I realized I wanted more from him, and I like kind of started to like him, and I was like, oh, I want you to have a happy ending. And so I slowly started building him up, and eventually he ends up becoming like one of the biggest characters in the book.
Wow. And
I'm like, I have no idea where he even came from. He just appeared in there, and I was like, oh, you know what, you actually are a major part of this book, and just kind of roped him in. And now all these other people who have read the book are like, oh my God, I love him so much.
I'm
like,
that's me too. Interesting. So the whole like process of writing books is crazy to me, because I was a big reader when I was like younger, when I was a kid, and I sort of lost it and refound it again in the past like year or so. And now as an adult, like reading, I'm reading a book right now called Babel, and it's like a, it's like 600 pages.
Yeah.
And it's just, like, keeping track of a story with all of these different characters is amazing. Building a universe is amazing. Yeah. And so you're like, ah, yeah, there's 30 or 40 characters in this next one. I'm like,
It's not nearly like that, though. This is still only a 300-page book.
So yeah, but still. Like, your brain does something that mine could never. Do you have, like, a map of, who knows who?
I will say, when I first started it, sadly it's not in the final book, but when I first started writing the book, I structured it so every single chapter was on it was on a day that the main character was working during his shift or after. So any time in between, like in school, that wouldn't be shown in the book at all. It would have to be picked up in during that. And each chapter started with an entire lineup sheet of every single person working that day. And so it listed every single name. So that's the only, I think that's why I did, like, I was able to keep everybody straight and figure out who all the characters were, is because I had that sheet every single time I started the chapter. I was like, all right, who's working today?
Yeah, who's working
that
today?
That was it. Sadly, it's not in the book, but it's better that way, I think.
Yeah. Oh my God, that's funny. You were basically clocking everyone in at the beginning of each chapter.
Who's the manager today? Oh, right. Okay.
Yes. Okay. Yes. That's amazing. I love that. So how did you get into, or how did you decide to write young adults? Like, were you a young adult reader when you were a young adult?
So I actually was not, because I couldn't find things that like intrigued me. I was a big reader, and I, at some point, like around probably, I would say like middle school, I stopped reading a little bit because I felt like I had matured a little bit more than all the books that I was reading. And I think it was just, I don't think I had actually matured like emotionally. I think I had just gotten to a point where the stories felt predictable. They felt like something I wasn't connecting with anymore, and I wanted to read something else. So I started reading Stephen King. I actually started reading Stephen King in like third grade. My mom bought me. My mom bought me my first Stephen King book was The Shining, and it was when the miniseries had just come out on ABC, and I was watching that, and I was like, Mom, can I read this book? And she's like,
I guess.
If you're going to read it, sure, I guess. Probably thinking I wouldn't, but it's like one of my all-time favorite books now. And so I started reading all of Stephen King, and I started trying to find books that I could connect with, even though I was a child. I was reading things I shouldn't be. And it's because back then, young adult novels weren't what they are today. And it wasn't until I started writing like books, and it was mainly for adults, but I read a book called The Knife of Never Letting Go by Patrick Ness. And it's a young adult novel. And it was like mind blowing to me how much the genre had changed. Mm-hmm. And I think I had started with The Hunger Games, and I read all of them, and I was like, oh, actually, this is pretty mature, but it's still like, was YA. Mm-hmm. But The Knife of Never Letting Go was like Hunger Games, but like a step up, where it was getting into like a lot more nuance of how society, and specifically like how men treat people and women, and all of these like really interesting ideas that I had never really seen in a young adult novel before. Mm-hmm. And on top of that, it was this really, really, really interesting sci-fi story. And so when I read that series, I was like, wait, so you could actually do more with YA than you can mm-hmm. with adult stuff, because adult stuff, adults aren't going to read. Usually adults don't read outside of what they think is for them.
Right.
Kids are going to do that. Like,
yeah,
I don't think that my parents would ever read a queer YA book mm-hmm. that I had not written pretty much.
Yeah.
And I think that with kids, I think teens are more open to reading things. Like a straight teen, I was at this one book festival and this kid came over. I'm assuming that he was straight. I could be wrong. Who knows? I didn't ask him his sexuality because whatever.
Yes.
And he's probably like 15 years old. I was one of the only teen authors there. There were about three teen authors there. And he just kind of came over and asked me what the book was about. I explained it to him. And he's just looking at it. And he, like, I expected him to be like, politely say, oh, okay, thanks. And then put it down and walk away. And right. he just looks at his mom. He's like, can I buy this? And she's like, if you want to, sure. And so he just like bought it. And I think teens are just more willing to be like, oh, well, I can read a book that happens to be gay because mm-hmm. it's just a book. I don't care. Like, I know it's not written specifically for me, but I can still connect with the characters if I like them. I can connect mm-hmm. with the story if I like it. Whereas adults don't really want to do that
yeah.
a lot. So, I mean, I'll read pretty much anything that sounds like it's an exciting story to me. Mm-hmm. I don't care who the main characters are. I don't care. I mean, if they're completely opposite of what I believe, then I'm not going to read it. But
yeah.
for the most part, I will read books about trans people. I will read books especially by Black authors about Black experiences. And I will still read it because I want to know if the story is good. And
yeah.
teens are much more open to doing that than adults
yeah.
are. And that's so that's why I started.
Point.
Also, it's kind of adult books are not nearly as diverse as young adult books.
Mm-hmm.
So I think because of that, I was like, I want to have queer characters in my books. And it's an easier sell than writing a queer adult book. Like even that,
yeah.
I asked my agent about, and it's a little iffy to sell a queer adult book. There's like maybe a couple, like a handful of them published every year. Whereas
yeah.
with YA books, there's probably, I think, like 8 queer books coming out a week at this point. So, which is...
Okay, that's amazing.
In 2015, by the way, was almost unheard of. Usually it was like 1 queer book a season and that's it.
Do you remember the first time that you found a book that you felt like represented you or the queer community? Like when you were a kid, or was it until you were kind of a young adult yourself?
It probably wasn't until I was an adult.
Mm-hmm.
I think there were authors who were writing those books and it was hard to find them. They
mm-hmm.
weren't like, publishers weren't putting money behind them. Publishers weren't marketing them. And
mm-hmm.
there was a book by, I forget the author's name, Perry, something Perry. But it's called Hero. It's about this queer kid who is in this world where superheroes exist. And he ends up like, he's gay and he's worried that his father is going to like hate him because he's gay. And he has a crush on this one superhero and ends up meeting this other boy who has superpowers and the two of them fall in love.
Mm-hmm.
And I just kind of like happened to stumble upon it at the bookstore and I was reading, I was like, it was kind of like thinly veiled gay
yeah.
on the back cover when I was reading it. And I was just like, is this gay?
Gay?
Is this kid gay in this? And so I'm like, I start reading it. And I'm like, I don't know. This is reading kind of gay. And I'm like, this is gay. And so like, and it ended up, it's like won like queer book awards and all of this stuff. And I had no idea what it was. And
so I
bought it and I was like, I'm going to read this book. And it was like the first time I was like, oh, wow, they're like really making gay books now. Interesting. And it wasn't just like for
That's
adults.
Hilarious.
It was only, I would... When Amazon became a thing,
mm-hmm.
I figured that's the easiest way for me as a closeted gay kid
yeah.
to buy gay books. So I would like go on and I looked up gay books and they were all for adults, and all of them had a lot of inappropriate sex in them. And
right.
Probably did you, shouldn't have been reading them, but...
Did you go to Amazon, the search bar, and just write gay books?
I think I probably did. I mean, it's not that much more advanced than me Googling, or I think it was Yahoo searching at the time when I first got the internet and was like, not realizing, I'm just like, naked men.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is it. This is what I like.
Yeah. Ah, yes. Confirmed. Got it. Thanks. And it was like, I don't know if you had the dial-up internet where your mom couldn't be on the phone the same time you were on there. So like
if you picked up the phone, it would disconnect you.
It would just disconnect you, which was like your worst nightmare because you're like, oh my God, a very stressful time.
Oh yeah. Kids these days don't know how easy they have it.
They don't even know. They could go on Pornhub like it's nothing, which is horrifying in its own thing.
But yes, let's ban the books from all the school libraries. That's more important.
How dare their pinkies touch?
How dare?
How dare? Absurd. That's so cool. It's so cool that now you've been able to create a part of this community and like the literary community. Have you had people reach out to you, like email you or DM you or anything, and give you feedback on the book, or how do you get your...
I get so many, and it's like every single one, every email I get, I get so excited because it's like, it's kind of like reminds me of why I am, because every once in a while I'll just be like, oh, I'm such a shitty writer, why is this so hard? And then I'll get an email and it's like, it's almost like people who read my book know I need the email right then.
Yeah.
And it's, I love how different all of them are. There's like, Some of the people are straight and they're like, I am a straight woman in my 60s. And I just have to tell you, I really love this book.
Yeah.
I think it's so sweet. It really connected with me. And I'm making sure everybody I know is reading it. And then I'll get stuff from like this kid in Illinois. Like his teacher wrote me an email saying how much he loved the book and like made him write me a letter. And it was this adorable letter. And I was like, I'm going to send this kid a letter back. And so I sent him a letter back and I sent her like a whole box of like young adult books for her library. And it was like, I've really loved getting emails from people. And a lot of them are like, the ones from like older people are like, I wish I had this book when I was in high school.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, that's exactly why I wrote it. Because I want kids that are in high school now to have it. And I want them to be able to see that they can have these stories and that they do matter. It's like, I know it sounds cliche, but it's when you have so much, there's such an obvious genre and there's one blind spot in it that has not been there. It's like, finally, somebody else is shining a light on that. And like, even the... I'm not sure if you watched The Last of Us, but...
Yes, I haven't watched the episode that just came out, but I'm caught up through episode 3.
I don't think
I've
watched that one, yeah.
Episode 3.
I got so many emails about that one because I was yeah, that's exactly what I was going for. And I watched it too, and I was like, I'm so glad that something like this... Because when I first got signed with my agent, his assistant told me about the video game, and I'm terrible at video games. They've just become too complicated.
Understand.
So what I do is I go online and I onto YouTube and I go and watch the movies that they edit all together as like one movie.
Yeah.
And I watch The Last of Us and I watch The Last of Us Part 2. And in The Last of Us, when they introduce the Bill and Frank storyline, it's really depressing. And I was like, oh, this sucks. That's, I don't like that. But they totally redeemed themselves and they made it so much happier. And it's like this sweet little moment. And I'm just so happy they did it that way.
Yeah.
And if you're like ugly crying during that episode and you know nothing else about it, just wait until the end of the show. Because when I finished this Last of Us Part 2, I was sobbing at my
computer.
It is the most emotional storytelling I have ever seen from a video game, and I cannot wait for the rest of this series. I am in all the way to the end.
Oh, me too. I'm so excited.
I was ugly crying at a fucking edited video game movie. And it was so, it made me wish I could play video games just so I could get through
experience
like the 30 plus hours of that to get to that moment.
Yeah, I understand. I was not a big video game person either. I like The Sims, and that's where I dropped the line.
Yeah, me too. You know? That's one I can still, even though Sims 4 is still really hard to play. I'm like, I struggle. I have to buy the houses. I can't build anymore. I used to love building in
me
The
too.
Sims 1.
I have no patience for it now. No, yeah.
It's too hard.
No patience now. It's like, I'm like, this is, I don't need to like HTML hack this entire thing. Like that, I'm playing this because I can't play anything else.
Yeah.
My God. But my brother played a lot of video games. So I like sort of when I don't know if you remember in the first episode where they get in the car and the shot from inside the car and you like horror movies too, right? Mm-hmm. So when like there's so many zombie movies, there are so many like kind of takes on that. The shot from inside the car, I think, was one of the most impressive shots I've seen like in TV, because you're following through. It felt like a video game.
I think it was taken from the video game because I was watching it and I was like, this is really familiar. And I think it was almost like a shot for shot remake of the video game, because I think during that time, you're playing, I think, in the video game as Joel. And I think you can pretty much just turn the camera. And so you can pick on what you're looking at while this is all going on. I think that's how it was. I could just be making that up. But as I was watching it, I was like, this is really familiar. I think that this is how they did it in the game.
Yeah, it was so cool and such like a well-made show. And when episode 3 came around, it was so interesting because you're like, for anyone who hasn't seen The Last of Us, the episode 3 is about
Frank and Bill.
Frank and Bill are two men who find each other in this post-apocalyptic, why is that so hard for me to say today? God, world, living out they end up living out the rest of their days together. That doesn't even spoil it, because watching the like the nuance and details of their life is just so beautiful. And Bill is played by Nick Offerman, which I was so, when I saw him pop up on the screen, I was like, this is the best, because he's viewed as being this like super masculine person in any other role that he plays. And he still is masculine in this role. And so he plays this like lesser represented, more masculine side of also still being queer and having this like really loving relationship with Frank. It's just so beautiful.
I love Nick Offerman.
Me too.
And him and Megan Mullally are the cutest couple in the world.
they're so cute. Did you watch Parks and Rec at all?
I did. I watched all the way up until I think the halfway through the fifth season, and then they took it off Netflix and I lost it.
Yeah. That's fair. I mean, you saw enough to see Nick Offerman and Megan, like their characters when she's Tammy. Cracks me up. They're so funny. They're so funny. So yeah, he has a lot of range and he made that character really come to life. The scene where he tries a strawberry that Frank grew, I was like, oh my God, not be crying at produce. I can't stand it. It was so beautiful.
I really love that scene because he, at one point he looks at Frank and he's like, I was never afraid until I met you.
Yeah.
And he like says that he's sorry that he's getting older faster than Frank is. And Frank's like, older means we're still here, which I feel like it's going to be overlooked by a lot of people, but the show starts in 2003 and then it jumps ahead to 2023. And all of that part is probably within the last few years. And that means the two of them were at the age where they were basically, I'm not sure if Bill was out at the time. I think he probably still wasn't sure about his sexuality, but he at least saw that all of these people were dying of AIDS in the 80s. And so when Frank says that to him, older means we're still here, I think he is specifically talking about the AIDS crisis and how so many people that they know from AIDS and the cordyceps now are no longer there, and how it's like they have each other and it doesn't matter that they're getting old and ugly and fat and blah, 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 which is like all of these things that queer people are so terrified of. And it's like, no, this is a good thing. This is a happy thing that we are here together.
Yes. Yes. I love that. Older means we're still here. It's like such a, honestly, some words to live by. And that
those such a simple line. And I was just like, oh my God, my heart.
Yeah. That's like that, you know, that's going to end up on like a rustic wood sign in Home Goods in a couple of years. And people will have it in their kitchens next to, like, what's the one that's like
live, laugh, love.
Yes. Live, laugh, love. I love it. It'll end up there soon.
Yeah.
I ask everybody who comes on the show if you have any specific dating or relationship advice that has stuck with you through your time. And you're married now, so you did something right.
Yeah, I think probably the most important thing is probably, I would just say, is communication, because I even need to take that for myself, because we have a lot of, when we enter into a relationship, we already have a lot of baggage from our family lives, how we're brought up and everything, and all of our experiences. So I think it's important to be able to communicate your wants and needs and talk with your partner, because it's one of those things that it took me forever to learn. And it could have been like stunted queer growth, because I wasn't allowed to be able to have a relationship until I felt comfortable with who I was. But for so long, I would just be quiet. I wouldn't say what was on my mind. And I basically was failing as a partner, because I just wasn't expressing my emotions. And I was just like, I want this. Let's do this. I want you to do this. I need you to talk to me like this. I need you to express this. This is how I'm feeling. And that's basically the easiest thing you can do.
100%. Just
have communications and open dialogue about what it is you want and how it is you're feeling. And you shouldn't be playing games. So I was watching the White Lotus, and that whole scene when Aubrey Plaza and the other girl in the pool, and she's talking about how she plays games. And I'm like,
yes,
I hate this. And I hope nobody is taking this as real advice. Oh. That girl is very, very, she should get an award for how she acted. However, I hope that people realize that this is not how you should be in a relationship.
Yes.
You have to talk about everything.
Yes. Yes. I agree. I also was I was cringing so much at that entire part. I mean, there's like, I think there's some value in having things be like to yourself. Like, it's important to always like maintain who you are in a relationship, but no one is a mind reader. There's no way that your partner is going to know how to do every single thing for you the way that you need it to be done to have this be sustainable. So communication. Yes. It's so much easier to just say, like, you know what? It would be really helpful if I made the dinner that night, that like you do the dishes, or we can do them together, but I don't want to do all of it by myself. And then later we can do X, whatever. Just having the conversation versus sitting there and like ruminating in it.
While you're scrubbing dishes and being like looking at them on their phone.
Yeah, exactly. Just have the conversation. You'll feel so much better. I agree. I think that's wonderful advice. Thank you so much for talking to me today. Do you want to, oh my God, literally anytime. Will you have Lose You to Find Me coming out spring? Is that what month is that coming?
May 16th.
Amazing.
And All That's Left in the World is out now in hardcover. It's also coming out in paperback in May 16th, if you want to wait for that. Although I will say, paperbacks are getting more expensive because paper's more expensive. Ugh. It's like $15.99 for a paperback. You might as well just buy the hardcover if you don't want to wait for it.
Yeah.
Also, the audiobook is really good. I'll say that. I haven't been able to listen to the audiobook for Lose You to Find Me yet, but I'm telling you, the audiobook in All That's Left in the World, if anybody hasn't read it yet and they're thinking about it, and you have like Audible credits, just pop on there and grab
pop it on.
Or check it out from your library.
I was just going to say,
support your local library, because all of the libraries are getting in a lot of trouble now. So they have queer books and everybody's standing up and trying to get them banned. So go and support your local library. Mm-hmm. Check out queer books. Even if you don't read them, you can check them out, take them home, and return them the next day. It still counts. It helps me. So.
Wonderful. I love that. I love that. Well, thank you so much for coming on. I appreciate it so much. I can't wait to finish All That's Left in the World. And I'm so excited for Lose You to Find Me. I'm very happy that I found someone new to read from. So I'm just very excited all around.
Thank you.
Put down that smartphone and listen to me. I'm Matthew Milligan, professional musician and lifelong Weird Al fan. Each week, I'm joined by professional podcaster and close personal friend, Matt Kelly, to take a dive off the deep end into the vast career of pop culture icon Weird Al Yankovic on our show, Weird Algorithm. Along with some very special guests from the worlds of music and comedy, we tackle every song, every television appearance, and every bit of sketch comedy Al has produced in chronological order, covering the good old days of My Bologna and Eat It, the fun zone of Tacky and White and Nerdy, and everything in between. As we go, we're ranking the songs, albums, and music videos in the hopes of creating the ultimate guide to a career bigger than the biggest ball of twine in Minnesota. So the next time you're having one of those days stuck in a traffic jam wondering why does this always happen to me, just kick off your sneakers and stick around for a while because we've got it all on Weird Algorithm, available wherever you get your podcasts. And now you know. Was that enough references? Put down that smartphone and listen to me. I'm Matthew Milligan, professional musician and lifelong Weird Al fan. Each week, I'm joined by professional podcaster and close personal friend, Matt Kelly, to take a dive off the deep end into the vast career of pop culture icon Weird Al Yankovic on our show, Weird Algorithm. Along with some very special guests from the worlds of music and comedy, we tackle every song, every television appearance, and every bit of sketch comedy Al has produced in chronological order, covering the good old days of My Bologna and Eat It, the fun zone of Tacky and White and Nerdy, and everything in between. As we go, we're ranking the songs, albums, and music videos in the hopes of creating the ultimate guide to a career bigger than the biggest ball of twine in Minnesota. So the next time you're having one of those days stuck in a traffic jam wondering why does this always happen to me, just kick off your sneakers and stick around for a while because we've got it all on Weird Algorithm, available wherever you get your podcasts. And now you know. Was that enough references?
You're listening to the Geekscape Network.